I was born and raised in Vienna.
In Vienna.
Austria, in the outskirts, not in the center. So I grew up between wheat fields, and I'm not a city boy, in other words. I was a soldier at the age of 16, and at age 18 I got injured, and I've been limping ever since. And I also lost the hearing
really?
On my right side at that time. So I've been been a little handicapped, but it didn't really stop me too much. In 1947, I finally came out of the hospital and went to art school. And in art school, well, I did the classical curriculum. But at one point, after having seen the work of Henry Moore, I began to see things differently. With particular attention to the anticlastic surface. Are you familiar with the term? It's the opposite of synclastic. Now, synclastic is where the curvature goes in one direction.
Okay.
And the result is the dome or the sphere. Anticlastic is the shape of a potato chip. All I need to say is Felix Candela, his roofs are anticlastic surfaces. They are curved in one direction positively, in the other direction negatively. So that's the kind of surface that it exists in nature. It's not all that prominent. We are all synclastic people, mostly. And I'm putting a lot of emphasis on the anticlastic because I think that's where I made a contribution up to the time when I undertook it. It was sort of embedded in Henry Moore's work, and it was more explicit in the work of Noam Gabo and Anton Pevsner, sculptors of Russian descent, constructivists, and they had come up with the hyperbolic paraboloid, but they had stopped there. That surface is cut off. It's not permitted to take its course to infinity or to wherever it wants to go. And that's interesting too. But I undertook to investigate what would happen if the hyperbolic parabola didn't stop here, but was permitted to go on. And that led to my infinite continuous surfaces. And it was not influenced by the Bauhaus. I didn't know anything about the Bauhaus here. I'm saying that because I'm proud of my independence. When I came to this country, somebody sent me to the Museum of Modern Art. Some architect from Vienna who liked my work and was connected to the museum. And there, they liked the work and they gave me some references. They didn't give me an exhibition. And that's where Philip Johnson came in as one of the references. Florence Knoll was a repeat client. She came several times and did some fine work. I'm really proud of what she did.
Met Irwin at Yale in 1985. When I started. So I took all of his classes, the 3D design, sculpture classes, introductory to sculpture and advanced sculpture, and we got along well. But I did come across Irwin, and we had sympathetic views of sculpture and surface and things like that, so we got along well. But then there was maybe a 15-year break, and about 7 years ago, so 2003 maybe, we bumped into each other again, and I discovered this side of his work. From the beginning, Irwin was able to produce, give us some molds, original molds.
Okay.
And sometimes they were master molds, or sometimes they were production molds. And we would have to clean them up or make them work again. And those were the first few projects, were from original molds, but they had limitations. The second thing that started to happen is architects wanted a different size, a different shape, a different material, and all of this meant working on a computer. And several projects Irwin was involved in, just primarily to comment, to say that should be a little bit more this way or that way, but I would have to undertake the majority of the design and refinement process, which then becomes the procurement of the materials, the learning how to use the materials, the training the employees how to make things, because it's too much for me to do by myself, and learning to use a CNC machine to actually make it, finding people that know more than I know, and then learning from them. Eventually we bought our own factory, and we bought our own CNC equipment, our own plaster equipment, and then all the way down to how to pack it, how to specify the box,
wow,
and how to drive the truck
to
deliver
much.
It. So, but it's
a lot of things.
I think in the beginning, someone has to go through that to appreciate everyone's job in an organization. As long as Irwin is with me, I want to make everyone a project.
Okay.
Because this is where I get to learn from Irwin. If I learn how to make one item a million times very efficiently, then I don't have a reason to come to Irwin every couple of days
right.
to ask him
right.
a question.
Right. Sure.
So he's a resource that the only way to take advantage of it
right.
is to do different things while he's alive. When Irwin mentioned the fad in the 60s and the market collapsed, it was mostly imitators. They would make a cinder block and put it on the side so you have a hole and say, look, it's like Irwin Howard's, but it's a big difference.
I deprive myself of that possibility of discovering things on the way to the goal.
It takes more time, at least.
It takes more time, well, 85 years. Thank you.